Dan's a longtime member of STLREIA. He's going to be talking about using trust to title your real estate. He is a real estate investor, a broker, consultant, and a trainer. And he also has a background in electrical engineering. I don't know if he wants me to say that or not, but that's, I attribute that to why he's such a detail-oriented guy. And there are a lot of details to know about trust. And tonight we're privileged to have him share some of his knowledge with us. And again, like you do with Rob, if you could hold your questions to the end, with Zoom it works out a lot better. So with at this point, I'll turn it over to Dan. Take it, Dan.
All righty. Can everyone hear me?
Loud and clear.
All right. Yep. Very good. So, well, thanks, Lloyd, for the introduction. Not electrical engineer, but electrical contractor. So for 36 years. So, but I appreciate the, I didn't quite get the, I'd go to the engineering route, but I've been a contractor. So certainly helped me out in my real estate business. So also got a plumbing license along the way. So anyway, back to the presentation today, and bear with me. I'm going to share my screen here, but this is my first Zoom presentation, so just work with me here. So just, can everybody see that? Okay, great. All right, so we're going to talk about using trust or title and deeds to real estate. And privacy, course, is the first layer of protection, and that's one of the main benefits that I know of, but we'll go into that in detail as we go forward here. So start off with the disclaimer: I'm not an attorney or an accountant, but I've been teaching this subject for more than 10 years, so but take it with a grain of salt. Alrighty, a little about me. I'll keep it short. I'm not a speaker that's going to tell you a lot about me, but I've been in real estate for a while, since early 2000s, 2004. Became a broker and then got into investing, and even got a chance to teach a couple of years at the Missouri Bar Conference. So that was fun, teaching real estate to attorneys. So anyway, that's enough about me. Like Lloyd said, let's keep the question and answers till the end. If you want to put them in chat or write them down so you can ask them at the end, that would be great. And I'm going to try to move pretty fast because I'm not sure. I've got a lot of material and I like to go through a lot. And then you guys can ask questions at the end. So, all right. So does title really matter? Well, it depends. And that's my answer to a lot of real estate questions, since there's a lot of details. And in this case, I think it depends upon how much you value privacy and some of the other benefits of titling assets in a trust or another entity. But a trust is best, in my opinion. So, and who can this benefit? Well, normally I ask for a show of hands, but it's a little harder to do on Zoom. So you guys know who you are. And that's really private because I can't even see you here. So, but you might fit into one of these categories if you're in real estate. And we'll talk about some of the benefits of different people and situations. So there's something for everybody here. Even if you're not into real estate, you might find some benefits here and different needs and benefits for you. So, but I get this this question all the time. Isn't this all just standard? Can't we just leave it up to the title company and the attorneys? And certainly an attorney can create a trust for you at a cost, of course. Typically that's an estate planning trust that an attorney would create. Few attorneys out there really have proficiency in the use of land type trust or title holding trust that we discuss here. When I got into it, I quickly found out that there wasn't a lot of advice out there to be had, at least in our local area, and it was kind of sparse around the country. So you sort of had to go it on your own. But there are some pros out there and attorneys out there that I utilize, from time to time. So, And for title companies, remember, they're just agents. They act on the buyers and sellers instructions. So they do what we ask them to do. They title it a trust or an LLC or in our personal name. And, you know, they're supposed to close the contract like we've written it. So their job is not to necessarily give advice. So, and they'll typically revert to their standard. And I can tell you, my standard and someone else's standards are very different. And I have a standard buying contract when I'm buying property, and it differs very much from my standard selling contract, but they still say standard purchase agreement at the top of them. So I think it's important for all of us to maybe learn what your standard is and figure it out. So, and adopt a standard for yourself. So back to title. So we're going to talk a little bit about how to take and give title and how to hold title. So just a basic course on deeds here about taking title. These questions come up a lot. General warranty deed. This is the standard that the title company uses. This is what you'll typically see. If you don't ask for anything otherwise and you submit a contract to the title company, they're going to typically prepare a general warranty deed. And it's going to have specific language in it governed by your state statute. And it's pretty common amongst most estates, but this is Missouri specific. The specific words have to be in the contract, like grant, bargain, and sell, convey, and confirm. And there's warrants and covenants that go with the contract. Usually it's fee simple estate. In other words, the buyer is transferring all his interest in the estate or the property to another party. You know, there may be exceptions to that, but most are fee simple. And they warrant good title. They warrant good title actually all the way back to when the land patents were first granted in the title. So when you sell to someone with a general warranty deed, you're saying that you have good title and you'll guarantee it and defend it all the way back. So if any breaches should come up. Now that's normally why the buyer buys title insurance, is to make sure that some third party is also saying the title is good, or if there's any defects, you're made aware of them. So, but the general warranty deed is the strongest form of deed to transfer property. It comes with the most responsibilities for the seller. The next form of deed, which we see in Missouri, is a special warranty deed, sometimes called a limited warranty deed in some states. But basically, it's very similar to general warranty deed, except that it only guarantees title during the time you own the property. So it says that you didn't further encumber the property while you owned it. So this is one of my favorite ways if I'm selling property, just because if there is a title defect that happened 40 years ago and it was to come up, although unlikely, if I transfer by special warranty deed and I didn't own it for the past 40 years, then I don't have anything to worry about. I wouldn't get named in a lawsuit if there was something to come up. So it's pretty easy for buyers to accept a special warranty deed. So I've never had an issue selling and using a special warranty deed. So, but again, I have to direct the title company as to that's my standard. And I put that language in my contracts when I'm selling. So that's when I use it. And basically it says that if I owned it for 2 years or 2 minutes, I didn't do anything to mess up the title. And I'm guaranteeing that during my ownership, I didn't cause a title defect. So, all right, a quit claim deed. Sometimes folks refer this to as a quit claim deed because they don't understand the language, but it's really a quit claim deed. And it really says, in effect, I may not own this property, but whatever I own is yours. So it is no warranty. It just says at this point in time, I'm giving you whatever I own in this particular property. And if you own title in a property and you quit claim it to someone else, it's just as strong or as good as a general warranty deed in that you've transferred your title. If you didn't happen to own it at that time, it really has no effect whatsoever. It also, there's no liability for you if you transfer by quit claim deed. If you didn't own a property or your title was somehow encumbered or there were something you didn't necessarily disclose. So there are uses for quit claim deeds. it's probably my least favorite way to obtain a property, and my most favorite way to sell one. But in most cases when I'm selling, I'm going to have warrant to title. And I have bought and sold properties with a quitclaim deed. And quitclaims are a lot of times used to cure title defects in a divorce situation to transfer title between a husband and wife, or in a situation where someone died and there's many heirs and an heir may or may not have a claim to the property. So that's many times what we see quitclaims being used for. The one thing about them is they don't pass any after acquired title. And I didn't talk about this earlier, but a general warranty and a special warranty deed both transfer after acquired title. What that means is if I deeded you something by special warranty deed and or general warranty deed, and later on I discovered that my title wasn't good, there was a break in the chain somewhere, or there was some issue that I didn't have good title. But I could go out and find whoever party or whatever was encumbering title and fix that so that now I get good title. If I've already deeded the property to you under a general warranty deed, and let's say 3 months later we discover that there's a problem with my original title, and I go out and I get that fixed, I get wherever the break was, I fix the break in the chain, and now I have good title. You don't have to get another deed. You automatically acquire what I already gave you or purported to give you in the general warranty deed. So when you're buying, you would like to buy with general warranty deed, which is the strongest form of deed to get, because you get that benefit of after acquired title. So, and that's good, but, because if someone, you find out an heir, some other heir might have had an interest in the property, you got the property by quitclaim deed, or you got the property by general warranty deed, and come to find out some other heir also had an interest. If they quitclaimed it to the original party, then you would then have clean title because you already got the general warranty deed. So that makes sense. So there are some other types of deeds too. We won't go into detail on these, but there's beneficiary deeds, deed trustee from a trust, a trustee under foreclosure, personal representative deeds when someone dies, there's conservator's deeds and sheriff's deeds. So, and there are specific instances when these deeds are used. And the type of deed does matter. Just briefly, the beneficiary deed is a type of springing deed. In other words, that's what you may use a beneficiary deed so that if when you die, title immediately passes to an heir. It's the most simplest form of avoiding probate. And it can be changed at any time, and it has no effect on the benefit. It has no effect in transferring title unless someone dies. So if you file a beneficiary deed saying your two kids get your property when you die, and they have no interest at this point in time until the party on the deed dies, they would not have any interest at all in the property. They can't enforce anything. They can't do anything. And you could change it at any time, all the way up to when you die. So there's specific deeds for specific purposes. So, all right. So how we hold title. This is more to the presentation today. This is the ownership. Whose name's in the deed? And this is audience participation again, but this is Zoom, so you'll have to think about this on your own. You don't have to raise your hand. So how many own your property in your own name? Maybe an LLC, a corporation, or other entity? Or do you own property with others? Are you husband and wife? Or do you own property with a partner as joint tenants or tenants in common? So we're gonna talk about these ownership entities and pros and cons of all of the above. So sole ownership versus husband and wife. So sole ownership is when there's one person, you're owning it in your name, you don't have any asset protection at all, lawsuits and judgments easily attached to your property. And a lawsuit can be as easy as you get in a car accident. And, unfortunately someone gets hurt and you're involved in a lawsuit. Well, as long as that lawsuit is in effect, it could affect your ability to transfer title to your property. Even if you're not at fault, if you're a named party in the lawsuit that hasn't been resolved, it can affect your ability to transfer assets that you own in your name since you were sued in your name. It also doesn't give you any privacy. It doesn't avoid probate, except in one instance, if you filed a beneficiary deed and you own it in your own name, you could avoid probate. But in general, it doesn't avoid probate. However, it's easy to finance. It's also the easiest. You've already got a name. It's the simplest way. It's probably the way that most folks own title to their properties in their own name. Then there's husband and wife. If you own with your husband and when you own with your spouse, in under the law, that's referred to as tenancy by the entirety, at least in Missouri and most states that have husband and wife provisions. That's a special classification. You're not joint tenants and you're not tenants in commons. It's considered tenancy by entirety. It's the best, if you're owning with someone else, it's one of the best forms of ownership because it gives you some asset protection. You get, and it's only available to husband and wife in the situation. You get creditor action against one party. They cannot force the sale of your house if you're own husband and wife. So that's a big benefit. It doesn't, you don't have any privacy. It doesn't normally avoid probate. But again, it's easy to finance. So the one big benefit, the husband and wife versus, you know, owning in your name or even in your name and your wife's name. Although if you're married, by default in Missouri, you know, if you're married and you owned it, you bought it, you know, while you're married, it's presumed that you would own a tenancy by the entirety as long as both your names are on the deed. Even if you don't say a married person or married couple, although that's a better way to name it on the deed. But there's been some court cases where it's presumed automatically that you're holding it under the tenancy by the entirety laws, statute. So owning property with others. Other than owning husband and wife, you can own a property with a partner or third party. Partnerships in general are probably not the best arrangement. Mainly because partners are generally jointly liable for another partner's actions. So partnerships are very easy to form. Obviously you can form them by putting both parties' names on a deed or an oral agreement that we're owning something together, and even the conduct you have in a joint venture, you know, can automatically put you in partnership status. So better to have written agreements and try to avoid partnerships in general where both parties can be liable for the other parties. So because title suits can be costly and time consuming in those cases. So, all right. So personal name versus LLC. So obviously with a personal name, you don't have any asset protection. But with an LLC, you do have limited liability. You don't have any privacy with your personal name. In an LLC, it gives you some privacy. And it depends upon how much privacy based on how you filed your LLC documents. So in Missouri, the registered agent and the organizer are the parties on the organizational paperwork. So depending upon the parties that are named on that, you may or may not have privacy, because a lot of folks create their own LLCs, which is nothing wrong with that, but it's an easy search to find out who the organizer is or who the registered agent is. So be careful if you're using an LLC for privacy. So make sure the documents that are filed help to maintain that privacy. So, and it can't avoid probate. And this is true in most states, in Missouri for sure. There's non-probate transfer language that can be put in the operating agreement so that the beneficial interests of the LLC transfer on death. So you can still avoid probate with an LLC, but you have to have the language in there. So, and I've seen many, many LLCs that are boilerplate somebody got from somewhere and do not have that language in there. So. They are a little harder to finance, except with our friend here, Rob, who can finance in LLCs. And I'm glad to hear he finances in land trust too. So that's great news. So there are some costs to set them up. Although in Missouri, it's not an ungodly cost. So I'm trying to tell you the benefits and the cost of everything involved out there, and not just preach one method, because everything, you know. solutions for us is we all got to decide on what works best for us. So, all right, on to my favorite subject, trust. So this is a good rule of thumb to remember. Trust are great for holding things, not necessarily doing things. So an LLC is good for doing things. Remember, it's an LLC, it may be a corporation. There are entities that are creatures of the state. They're created by state statute. And they're great for doing. When I say doing, I mean conducting business, renting properties, running construction businesses, managing properties, doing. Trust aren't as well for those types of things. Now, you can create those kind of trusts, but we're not going to talk about those kind. And generally, the tax structure is burdensome in those types of trusts. So I like my trusts that I talk about are generally for holding title and holding things. So it's a good way to kind of separate the two. And trust concepts aren't new. They've been around way, way, way longer than LLCs and corporations and other forms of ownership. In fact, 3,900 years. So there's early evidence of trust arrangements being created. So what is a trust? Well, it's really a relationship or contract that created the direction of an individual in which one or more persons hold someone else's or hold the property subject to certain duties to use it, protect it for the benefit of others. And the type of trust we're going to be discussing tonight is a revocable grantor trust. That's only one name we're going to give it, but that's an IRS classification. And that's an Illinois type land trust. And I say Illinois type because this trust concept was first formed in Illinois. So that's the concepts we'll be talking about tonight. So, all right. Now let's go to personal name versus trust. We've already talked about the personal name, so I'll talk about the trust. The trust offers some limited liability based on privacy. And they're super private. Only the trustee's name on file, and the trust is not recorded. They can avoid probate. They have the same finance considerations as an LLC, and it's an entity. You gotta find someone who's going to finance under that situation. But there's really no cost to set up, other than maybe an initial cost to have one created or to learn how to do them yourself, which is what I advocate. But you can, if you've just got a print button on your computer, it can change the name of the trust and the trustee and the legal description. You can have a new trust every time. So let's talk about LLCs versus trust. I know LLCs are a great form of way to own property. And they do have limited liability. And trust also are limited liability. It's a different form. It's mainly based on privacy. It's not the asset protection shield of an LLC, but it offers great privacy. An LLC can offer some privacy like we talked about, but it depends who's the registered agent organizer. With a trust, only the trustee's name is on file in the name of the trust. So, anyway, and the big benefit of trust is they work great in conjunction with LLCs. And maybe you need less LLCs. I know that discussion came up earlier. If you use trust, I would also suggest still using LLCs, but maybe they're at a different level. The trust is at one level and the LLCs is at a different level. So, didn't mean to go into this part of today or right now, but since that question came up, if you've got four or five properties that have loans on them, they're encumbered, that's one layer of asset protection because the lender has got first dibs on any potential rights to the property. Depending upon how much total equity you have in four or five properties, and I just use that number as a general number, you may consider putting them all in different trusts, but the same LLC as the beneficiary at the bottom. So you only have one LLC and maybe you have four or five properties in that in different trust. But because they're different trusts, they don't appear to be common ownership because they're not. They're all owned in trust, even though the beneficiary might be a common beneficiary like an LLC. It allows you a lot more flexibility at the titling level. And you could put more than one property essentially into the same LLC for for tax purposes, but on the public record, they're in one, they're in different trusts. All right, so what exactly is a trust again? Well, it's a contract between the creator of the trust and the trustee for the benefit of the beneficiary. It has to meet the legal requirements of the state in which it's enforced or created. The basic elements, you've got a creator, which is also known as a trustor, grantor, or settlor. You've got the property or subject matter. You've got the intent, why are you creating the trust? We've got a trustee and a beneficiary. And we're talking about express trust. That means they're deliberately created by the parties involved. And that means they're usually in writing. Remember, we already said it was a grantor type trust. That's an IRS classification. Express trust means it's deliberately created. It's also an express trust. It's also an inter vivos trust or a living trust. So it fits all these categories. And that's true of many trusts. They fit more than one category. The trust we're going to be talking about, you know, have several different classifications. So trustor, creator, grantor, settlor. When you're reading trust documents in a different trust, different words are used to signify the same party at the trust. It's the party that creates it. The subject matter, that's going to be the property. And you have to be able to define the property when the trust is created. Otherwise, the trust fails to exist. Without anything in the trust dies of its own accord. So there has to be a reason, and there has to be a definite something put into the trust. It could be something very small, but if that's not done fairly early in the creation of the trust, then the trust would automatically cease to exist. So, and it just about anything that could be freely transferred can be held in the trust. I mean, you could create a trust and put grandma, and just by stating that grandma's chair is in the trust, it would vest the title of that chair in the trust, because there's, you know, a chair is not something that would have, you know, title. It's not a title asset. So you could just name certain assets in order to put them into a trust. So as long as it has something in the trust. And the purpose and intent of the trust. So there has to be a reason to put something in the trust. And usually that's to deal with the property for the benefit of someone else. And then there will be a trust agreement or a declaration of trust, which will define what that use is and who the parties are. All right, so the trustee, who should the trustee be? Well, it should be someone you trust. And normally the trustee is the party that in the trust has the ability to act without further encumbrances and to carry out the duties of the trust. Now the trustee is obligated though to follow the directions of the trust. Remember the trust contract is between the creator of the trust, I use the word creator because it's not ambiguous as to who that party is, and the trustee. And the creator and the trustee, you know, have the contract, and the trustee has to carry out the intent of that contract. So normally they have the power of direction to act guidance of the contract. So who can be a trustee? Well, anyone who has legal capacity to take, hold, or administer property can take, hold, administer property in trust. And even a corporation or partnership or an LLC can act as a trustee subject to state laws and subject to specific language in their operating, in their organizational documents, whatever that may be, whatever type of entity it might be. There are some limitations for entities operating as trustees. And normally I don't recommend that, except in maybe a very limited situation. So who can be a beneficiary? Well, that's any person in legal or entity legally capable of taking and holding legal title of property. And the beneficiary holds the beneficial interest in the property. This is the ownership of the trust. So this is likened to the shares of a corporation. If you own 100% of the shares, it's the same as owning 100% of the beneficial interest in a trust. If you own an LLC, those are called membership interest. But in a trust, typically referred to as beneficial interest. And then the trust documents. So the heart of the trust would be the trust agreement or declaration of trust. And it determines what the trust, why it was created, who the parties are, and what, how it's to be administered. Who's to pay the taxes, who's to be responsible for what things the trust holds. So, and then there are other documents. If we form a trust, we got to put the property in trust. So we might warranty deed or quit claim deed it to the trustee. We have to appoint a trustee. We might use a certification of trust if we're selling property or buying property in a trust. That's a document we typically provide to the title company. And usually they have a form for that too. So but that's got limited information on it. Remember, a trust is private. So for the most part, during the ownership of a property in trust, we've got a lot of privacy. And there's assignment of beneficial interest. That's a way of transferring title in a trust without any public record. If I hold the property in trust, I could assign my interest to someone else for a fee possibly, or for a note, or for payment, without the trust or trustee ever changing name on title. So there's a lot of uses for that in partnership agreements, and maybe in lending agreements. It could help to avoid seizing in some cases with lenders who have seizing issues. And then there's a letter of direction in the trust that we use, which where the beneficial interest might give directions to the trustee on how to act. So what about the legality of trust? You know, I've said they've been around for, or trust concepts have been around for 3,900 years plus. Well, we're protected by the Constitution, really, in the sanctity of contracts, because the trust is really just a contract. And several articles in the Constitution show that we've got the ability to have contracts, and nothing other, unless we're creating a trust for something that's in violation of a state law. If you create a trust to hold your illegal drugs, that probably would be considered a violation of state law. But other than that, you can create a trust to hold anything that you can physically own. Again, we're talking about grantor trust, again, which is a IRS classification. So we're talking about revocable grantor trust. So this is also the type of trust that most estate planning trusts are. It's a revocable grantor trust. The grantor and the revocable means that we can change it during the life of the trust. The creator can change it. Grantor trust, the grantor is an IRS classification, meaning that it's directly or indirectly controlled by the creator or someone named in it. And it's a living trust, and Illinois type land trust are examples of these types of trusts. So, well, what are the tax implications? What am I gonna have to file special taxes? Well, no, according to the IRS Revenue Code 677, specifically about these type of land trust, they're considered as a pass-through type trust. So it's disregarded as an entity for tax purposes. Whoever the beneficiary is in a land trust is the party that would be the taxable party. If that's an LLC, if that's you personally. So putting something in a trust, this type of trust, doesn't change your tax return at all. So no extra tax paperwork to complete. Okay, so why would you consider trust? Well, they're a private agreement, operate under the radar. I think privacy alone is the single most benefit, especially with today's world, when a quick Google search you can find out just about anything on anybody you want to. That alone, especially if you're a landlord and dealing with tenants and other parties, can protect you. And it can protect you from frivolous lawsuits. When you have the contingent fee attorney, someone goes to the contingent fee attorney with a slip and fall, and the attorney says, "Okay, Mrs. Jones, let me look up your landlord," and you know, when they look up the landlord, it comes back with the Redbird Preservation Trust, and they look up the Redwood Preservation Trust, and they find out that the Redwood Preservation Trust doesn't own anything else. It only owns this one property. And guess what? That property may also be encumbered by a loan. Well, the landlord doesn't see any big, or the landlord, the lawyer does not see any big landlord here. Doesn't either see a way where he might get paid from a landlord necessarily, because he doesn't really know anything about the Redwood Preservation Trust. And in fact, maybe that's a not-for-profit trust. And he's not real anxious to sue a not-for-profit trust for, especially if he doesn't think there's much to be had there. So they may just well take that lawsuit up, or, you know, on a contingent, on a retainer basis. Look, you know, I'm happy to take that up on a retainer basis instead of a contingent fee basis. So you should never use this trust to avoid avoid being a responsible landlord or a responsible person, but it could avoid frivolous lawsuits. And it can give you some freedom to buy and sell properties if you do have liens and judgments in your name. Maybe you had some mistakes in the past that you're trying to get past, so it can help you to get past those. And they're also easy to create and free if you know how. So like I said before, they work great in conjunction with LLCs. So where could you learn about trust? Well, would you be surprised? I actually teach a class on that. So I've taught a class 8 years running, and then I skipped a couple years, and I'm going to teach one later this year. So let's talk about lawyers and trust. These type of trusts are not big ticket items in the accounting legal professions. In fact, except for financial estate planning, there's few reasons for many lawyers to gain proficiency in these types of trusts, even the use of trust. I found it difficult to find attorneys that were versed in trust, in this land trust, when I got started 15 to 20 years ago using trust. So, but I do always have an attorney in class who knows these type of trusts, and sometimes we have more than one attorney. So I've had several attorneys attend my class to learn more about these types of trusts. So there's definitely some good legal advice out there for those who, you know, want to speak to an attorney and make sure that you're getting good advice. But why not learn to do them yourself? So in this seminar, we go through trust concepts, history and trust theory, the parties of the trust, which we talked a little bit about, basic trust elements, creation, trust legislation, how to title, and we go over the operation of the trust. I'll go kind of quickly on these: insurance, how to carry insurance, how to get financing, which Rob already told us that they do that financing in their trust, the tax considerations, dealing with the title company, renting of trust property, property management, and beneficiary agreements. So, and we also go through naming strategies, the trust domicile, that means where does your trust live? How does that affect if there is a lawsuit, selecting a trustee, beneficiary considerations, a spendthrift provision, which could protect you from creditors, how you can do 1031 exchanges with the trust. Does it affect your ability to do those? Should you have co-trustees and co-beneficiaries, successor trustees, beneficiaries, using the director or trust certificates? So a lot of the seminar that I do is a hands-on seminar, because there's a lot of discussion. This is not an exact science. It's more of an art form. The trust document itself is one part of the trust, but deciding what to name your trust, how to take title, is it for you? Those are personal things. And so there's a lot of discussion about why are you doing it? What benefit it is for you to do it. So, you know, I get this too. I already have an LLC or corporation. Why should I use trust? Well, it gives you more privacy. LLCs and, like I say, corporations are registered, not the trust. And it also, it has less exposure for LLC. I mean, I have LLCs that no one really knows exist because they don't do business and they've never done business. So you would never have a reason to even look up the LLC because it's at the bottom of one of my trusts. So, and it's, you know, if the LLC is never exposed, I don't use that LLC that holds title in my properties as the manager of my properties. It provides me a first line of defense, a layer of protection. They're great for joint ventures. They're not as costly as individual LLCs. And combined with LLC and a trust, they increase your privacy and asset protection, give you a little freedom. And personal property trust is something we didn't talk a lot about. But you can use personal property trust for other stuff, like cars, guns, stocks, and boats. And by putting your assets into different trust, and I create a different trust for almost every asset, certainly every property. And for personal property, I may put more than some. I might not put every piece of personal property in a separate trust, but certain ones I would. If you've heard of gun trust, that might be it's a certain type of trust that folks use to hold guns that offers some interesting capabilities. And they're really an inexpensive first layer of protection and privacy. And if you combine them with an LLC or another state asset or state-created entity, they're very formidable. So you might say, well, I already have a living trust. Well, then this should be easier for you. Why would you need other trust if you have a living trust? Well, I think a living trust is a great thing to have for your estate planning, especially if you've got considerable assets. But why expose your living trust to the public record and the threat of being sued? Put a layer of protection between your living trust and the assets. So, and this should be easier for you to learn. If you already understand the trust concept, then this would be much easier. And this is a way to keep your living trust very private. No one knows that it exists except your beneficiaries, the people who matter. So, and you don't title directly into your living trust. It could be the beneficiary of your land type trust. So most folks create a living trust to avoid probate, which are great to do. But by putting one more layer in there, which you could do yourself by learning to do it, you get a lot more than just probate protection or probate avoidance. So again, benefits of trust. I'm sorry, this is a dry subject, I know. So I don't have any good jokes to tell. So you can avoid probate and related costs, you can avoid frivolous lawsuits potentially, you can avoid liens and judgments attaching. It limits your helps to limit your liability. You can also have a trust that you can avoid some personal problems with beneficiaries. And that's where the spendthrift provision comes in. And that's in any type of trust where you can have a beneficiary on a trust that might have some or have had some legal or other issues, and you can maybe some creditor issues, and a properly formed trust can avoid some of those, avoid the ability of the creditor coming after the trust. You might be able to avoid real estate brokerage laws. There's some carve outs for trustees of trust and to buy and sell and then act in ways with property that are specifically excluded in real estate brokerage. So, and you can potentially avoid seasoning problems. And you could buy real estate subject to the loan. It also helps with multiple owners, transferring interest, changing beneficiaries is a matter of changing a piece of paper in your file. It can make gift giving simplified. In fact, you can set it up where you could gift the statutory limit every year of your beneficial interest. They say the statutory limit under the current IRS code that you can gift without taxes. You could set up a document where you could gift a percentage or a dollar value of the beneficial interest on paper to a piece of property so that you're giving something slowly to your heirs and avoiding taxes for them fairly simply. So if you're a lender, actually a trust can make it easier to foreclose on a property in the case of a default. It's very hard for a trust to file bankruptcy, especially if the trust only owns that one asset. And bankruptcy is a way that stalls lenders from foreclosing. It doesn't prevent it, but it generally lengthens the time frame and cost. If a borrower files for bankruptcy during a foreclosure action, so it's great for lenders. It's great for negotiation. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. I think that might be in my opinion, the second reason for having properties in trust and property management. So I mentioned subject to financing. I'm sure most of you know what that is, but that's if you take a title to someone else's property and you leave their loan in place and you agree to make their payments, but you don't assume responsibility for the loan. A trust can allow you to do that with a little bit of privacy, since the lenders generally don't want you to transfer title without paying off the loan. And we're talking about institutional lenders here, not, you know, private or hard money lenders. But if you're taking over an existing institutional loan, I've bought many, many properties subject to the financing, so using trust. So who can use this? Well, the parties we mentioned earlier, landlords, instead of being the owner of the property, you're now a manager, or it's much easier to deal with tenants when you're not the person that owns the property. It can be great for joint ventures with rehabbers, and many hard money or private money lenders understand this, as does we heard earlier. For wholesalers, it can keep your name out of the chain of title. If you're a seller and you have owner finance, you can take back paper in the name of a trust. The note can be held in the trust. And then you can use it if you value more privacy in your life. I'll give you some examples in just a minute. Again, one more time for the landlord benefits, since I know we got a lot of landlords on here. You or your company don't own the property. You can be just the manager. You're not the decision maker. You have to get approval. You'll see what you can do. You might be able to if the owners approve. Be the advocate for the tenant. It's less adversarial. I mean, even when I have a tenant that's behind on rent, you know, and they ask me to waive late fees, I have to check with someone. You know, even though they don't know I happen to own the shares of the trust, but I don't own the property. And so I, you know, it puts me in a much less adversarial. In fact, they'll call me and say, ask me what, can you check with the owners and see what we can do? And so it puts me in a much better position with tenants. So I hope none of my tenants are listening. In negotiations, after privacy, I think this is one of the best benefits. The buck never stops here. I'm not the owner. I mean, the board of trustees meets on Tuesday. I'll find out. I might be able to get the owner to blah, 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 blah. Would that be fair? I'm just the manager. I'm just the junior manager. Let me see what I can do. Let me check with the trustee. So, and that could be when you're buying property, selling property, renting property, managing property. It leaves you a way, you know, to not be the person who has to have the answer to every question at that point, or is the one that, you know, that is the decision maker and can do something for them. I know I had an electrical contracting business for many years, and I had my last name associated with it. And, you know, the problem with that, it's great because I did good business, but when someone comes to you about a bill or an invoice, they know they're talking to the owner. And I had no way to say, hey, let me see what I can do, because I was the guy that could see what it could do. So I lost the ability to negotiate things that I would have had if I'd have used another name, just a generic name for my contracting business, and not have everyone know I was the buck did stop here. So a few real life examples that I know of, or either personally or otherwise. There was a dog bite in Florida, and there was a lawsuit, and the manager said he was just an agent of the trustee, and under the law, there was no liability for the trustee, and so they dropped a suit. Then the trustee quit in the middle of the lawsuit, and the replacement trustee was in California, so the court lost jurisdiction, and the lawsuit was dropped. So, will that always happen? No, but it's more complex. If it's a frivolous lawsuit, This was an issue where the tenant was not supposed to have a dog. But when the dog, when someone got bitten by the dog, guess who got sued? The landlord. So that, which was a trust. And the, because it was a trust, it was too, it was complicated. It became too complicated. It really wasn't the, and it wasn't the landlord's fault that the person got bit or that the dog was there. It was a tenant's fault. So it can help you avoid those kinds of things. I had a property I rehabbed, had to deal with a plumbing inspector. He was insisting that some work that would, should have been grandfathered was needed to be replaced. And when we brought that to his attention, he said, "Nope, it's got to be replaced." I said, "Well, I can't. I don't have authority. I have to take it to the board of trustees, and I need something in writing from you citing the specific violation." Well, he escalated it and escalated it, and finally, I got, "We're going to let this pass this one time." Well, it shouldn't have been an issue at all. There was nothing wrong with it. It had been put under a previous code. It had passed inspection. They just didn't like it. The fact that the new code required something different, but it worked. And because I told them I had to go to the board of trustees. So I know of another case where someone sold a property and he was sued over a property tax bill. There was some issue with the closing that didn't get resolved. And I guess the buyer had bought it knowing that, but later decided to sue the prior owner. And they went in and said, "Well, I own the property. It was owned by a trust." And guess what? The trust has no assets right now because the property had been sold. That was the only asset of the trust. The lawsuit was thrown out. And no liability to try to collect this, this tax bill. Being pulled over by the police, you know, I know of someone who, I was asked, "Do I own this vehicle? Do you own this vehicle?" "It looks like it's owned by the law enforcement, such and such trust." And I said, "Yeah, that's the case." And guess what? I got a warning, because it seems like it's a pretty good trust. I support law enforcement for sure. So just the name of a trust in certain situations can signify something. I didn't purport to signify anything other than a name, but I certainly support law enforcement. So, and these are real life examples of some that I'm personally aware of. So, are you at risk? Are you sure? There's risk in everything we do. Driving a car, crossing the street, climbing a ladder, on and on and on. So, and asset protection is really about dividing up a risk. Driving a car is probably one of the riskier things we do because no matter what, how you own your car, in a trust or otherwise, if you're the driver and you get sued, it won't matter how you own the car. Even in an LLC, you'll be sued personally. And the owner will be sued. So, but having it in a trust could avoid you from some contingent liability. If you loan your car out to me, maybe, and it's owned in a trust, and I get in an accident, well, I'll get sued and the owner will get sued, but the owner's a trust. And guess what? The trust owns only that car. So, even your car having it in a trust, in addition to maybe law enforcement benefits, it could provide you some protection from someone you loan your car to or loan your car out to. So one more time for audience participation. And again, you don't have to raise your hands. Do you want more privacy? Are you in real estate? Do you drive a car? Do you want to get your name off public record and learn how to operate smarter moving forward? I think you should consider trust. And I can show you how. So I do a 2-day seminar and it's going to be later this year. I haven't announced a date yet. Let's see. But if you email me to get on my reservation list, we'll give you a special discount. And I'll certainly, in the meantime, can answer any questions you have about trust, or I get lots of questions on trust pretty regularly, and that keeps me sharp. So if I don't know something or have any issues, we figure out something that'll usually work. So if you decide to come to the class, you get all the sample trust paperwork I use, and if you potentially have some trustees you might want to use, because a lot of what we talk about in class, in addition to learning about trust and how they work, but is, well, who do you select for to be a trustee? And, you know, how do you, and then you might want some successor or alternate trustees. Who should they be? Should it be you? Should it be a friend? Should it be a fellow real estate investor? Should they be local? Should they be out of the state? Should they be out of the country? And we talk about all those considerations, who they can be, who they can't be, who they should be. And it's different for different folks. So your situation, you know, everyone's situation is not exactly the same, but I tell you what I do and, you know, and how it's changed over the years. I've formed hundreds of trusts for myself and others. So, and helped folks do this. So I've got a lot of what works and what doesn't work. We even talk about how to kind of bury the trustee's name on the deed, which you can't do in St. Louis City very easily. But in most of other counties in Missouri, you can bury the trustee's name on the deed. And it makes it even harder if someone was trying to track you down. So, you know, and I'm all about doing things above board, and I'm a good landlord and a good steward and a good business person, but I also value my privacy. So anyway, any questions, answers, I'll try to have the answers. And here's my contact information again. And we'll open it up for questions.
Hi, Dan. I had a couple of questions for you. This is Rakesh. I've made the mistake that you mentioned in the beginning of your presentation. I was very quick to start individual LLCs, put all the individual properties in, title the property to the LLC, but the privacy, quote unquote, cat is out of the bag now. My name as owner, agent/agent manager is all over Secretary of State's website. If you do a search, you'll find my name on multiple properties. So question I have is, is there a way to put the privacy cat back in the bag?
There is. This is not a completely foolproof way, but it's pretty good. So, and you're not unlike a lot of folks out there. So what we, and this is what we teach in classes, you need the properties from the LLC to your trust, to a trust, and to an individual trust. We create trust for each property. You might not do this all at the same time if you really want to make it, you know, privacy is the game here. You can still leave the LLC as your beneficiary, so nothing changes. But you deed them into a trust. And we talk about what kind of deed to use, the benefits of what kind of deed to use. Because a lot of, you know, estate planning trust says, yeah, just use a quick claim deed, put it in your trust. But I usually don't recommend that. I usually generally recommend a warranty deed for this situation because it looks like a standard sale. And then you're going to send a letter to your tenants that says, hey, Mary tenant, guess what? I sold my property. I'm getting out of the ownership of real estate and I sold my property. However, I'm staying on as manager for an indefinite period of time. So, you reframe it with your tenants that you're not the owner anymore because you aren't, you're not lying to them. You're not the owner anymore. You're going to deed them out. You might stagger how you deed them out. So it doesn't look like it all happened at once, although I don't know if there's any specific reason not to do them all at once, but now the LLC is now on title. That solves your initial issue with the LLCs. You know, beyond that, but no one can, since no one sees the trust, they don't know that your trust might still be the beneficiary of the LLC. To the world out there, it's a standard sale. There's a deed transfer.
Okay. And then I've seen the follow-up question to this is I've seen some folks put their LLCs and have a trust company kind of become the manager of it. So rather than deed the property from the LLC to the trust, they actually have the LLC manager, a trust company. Does that achieve the same goal of privacy? Because now your name is not on the LLC. Nobody can do a search on, you know, Secretary of State's website and find, oh, you own 10 properties. So you're a cash rich and a property rich target.
So who are they deeding the properties to?
The properties are still owned by the LLCs. If you go to, you know, DOR's website and you put the property name, the LLC still owns the property.
Okay.
But then you look up, okay, what is the property address, what's the address of record for that entity, the LLC, and you follow the LLC route from, I make it sound like I'm doing some online sleuthing, but this is basically what I've done. I look up at a property, it's owned by this LLC. This LLC has address of record in the Secretary of State's database of this company is the manager and the, you know, that's where the trail ends. So I don't know who's behind the trust because the trust company is the manager on the LLC documentation filed with the Secretary of State.
Oh, okay. Well, you mean, so you're basically making a change on the LLC as far as who the registered agent is?
Correct. So does that achieve the same thing?
No, not really, because you can see all the documents. You know, there's no, so when I go to the LLC, when I go to the Secretary of State and I do a search on an LLC, I go back to the first time when it was created. I don't look at the 14 changes in registered agent. I look at the original creation date. And that's usually where people messed up, where they put down, a lot of times they're the organ. So there's two parties on the LLC that are disclosed,
right,
in Missouri. It's not the member or manager, although they could be if you record your paperwork. But the only two parties are required to be disclosed is the organizer and the registered agent. Now, if I'm using an attorney to create my LLC, which a lot of times I will, I want my attorney to be both the organizer and the registered agent. Now, I've had attorneys screw that up, and I don't know why I paid them, because I realized it later that they did that, because the only reason I would pay an attorney to create an LLC, which you can do pretty easily, is because I want their name or somebody else's name as both parties. So, but once that's done, you, even though you change it next year, it's still, you could still look back and see who is the organizer who created it. The registered agent is really just a figurehead for lawsuits. The only purpose of the registered agent is if you get sued, that's who they have to notify. That's the party they have to notify. So you're required.
Doesn't it get the same privacy, right? So you are directed towards a trust company who you don't know whether that trust company has ownership of the LLC or they're
registered. They almost never, if it's a trust company, have ownership of the LLC. But if you're trying to change your existing LLCs,
mm-hmm,
you're not going to hide that prior document where it showed you as the registered agent or the organizer.
But how does deeding the property into an individual trust protect or wipe, you know, clear those tracks?
Well, because the LLC doesn't own it anymore. A trust owns it. LLC sold it. Now when they look up 123 Main Street, they see it's owned by the Sisters of St. Mary Trust.
Okay. And inside the trust, you can have the LLC still own it.
The LLC owns the trust.
Got it.
So then when they do a public search, see, and you're only going to use a different trust for every property. So now when someone looks up that property, finds out it's owned by a trust, and then they do a search in that trust, guess what? Trust doesn't own anything else.
Right. So how do title companies, I don't want to take all airtime. I'll stop talking if anybody else has another question, but I have one last question.
Sure.
So you said the trust is not recorded anywhere, right? You could write it up as long as you follow those four things, trust or subject matter, trustee, beneficiary, and trust document, and you're a printer, you got a trust. If it's not recorded, does it prevent you from selling the property later on because the title company cannot do a general warranty deed on it because they have no way to verify, because title companies need to verify the chain of ownership so they can warranty the title is free from defects. Okay. So does it create a problem for you when you're trying to sell it? Because there is no way to verify whether you really have a clear title or there are some issues with the title.
Well, no, it doesn't create a problem, but if you do it correctly. So, A, you're going to deed the property into a trust and you're going to have a trust document that's not recorded, but the deed going into the trust is going to be recorded. and it's going to have a named trustee on there and maybe some alternate trustees. So we use a specific type of deed usually when we do that, or we generally try to put the trust language on the deed. Doesn't matter either way, you can still sell it. When you go to sell it, the title company, we have trust law in Missouri. Missouri's adopted the Uniform Trust Code with some caveats, but generally when you sell it, they're going to have you fill out a trust certificate. And they're going to provide you a form for that. And it's the things the statute requires them to verify before they can, because they want to make sure that A, the trustee that's on the deed is the current trustee, because since trustees can change, they want to make sure that the trustee has the power to sell the property. That's defined in the trust document. And that the trustee has the authority to sell the property. And that's defined in the trust document, whether they can make that decision on their own or whether they need direction from somebody. And then if that form is filled out properly, then the title company takes that certification of trust, and then they close based on certification of trust. And that's well established in trust law as a means of transferring title. It's no different than owning it in your living trust. Remember, this is a form of a living trust. Now, there are rules to follow, though. And when you're holding, you're going to be able to sell it. I've had to go through and fix problems in the past where other folks ran out and got a form somewhere. And, I took many classes before I was comfortable with it. And I still take some of the legal continuing ed for attorneys so that I can try to stay up on any changes in statute. But once you learn it, it's fairly simple. But it is a complex, it's not something you grasp in your first couple hours sitting down to, because there's always other questions that come up. But yeah, I've had no problem selling property in a trust. Worst case, you may have to show your trust at closing, but if you're selling it, it really doesn't matter.
Yes. Yeah.
A lot of title companies will ask for the trust. I generally don't have to provide the trust, but why? I've been using the same title company for years. B, I have a good relationship with the underwriters. They know I know what I'm doing. Your title company's worry is they don't want to insure a title where someone's cobbled together some paperwork and they might have to defend it. They have a really strange, their duty to defend title is it's pretty broad. Anyone can bring a suit against title. The title company, if they've insured title, they have to stand up and defend it, even if it's the most frivolous lawsuit there is. So they're trying to avoid those situations. So that's why having some education and knowing how to do it and how to talk to them, usually it's a pretty smooth process after you've done one or two. So the first couple, it's like everything else you've never done before. It's kind of like selling with your LLC you've never done before. Oh, we need your operating agreement. Oh, we might need an amendment. We might need you fill out this paperwork saying that you can sell the property. You know what I mean? So it's basically learning how to do the paperwork and making sure that they're covered too.
Thank you. Now that answered all my questions I had.
Okay. I see we got a couple of people with their hands up. Dave Lee I believe had his hand up first. Go ahead, Dave.
Yeah. Hi, Dan. So you mentioned that the trust needs to accept subject property as one of the conditions for the trust. But does that happen to, I guess I'm trying to work out the timeline with the time when you create the trust and appoint a trustee so that then the trustee can go to closing and sign the paperwork. There's that 2-week gap or something where, in essence, you've created the trust, you've appointed a trustee, but it doesn't have property yet until you go to closing.
There's several ways to handle that. A 2 weeks might be okay if you're you're probably under contract when you're creating the trust. What we typically do is, when I go under contract, this is one of some of the things that we talk about in the class, because there's more to the meets the eye. When I go under contract, I usually go under contract in my name. Dan Bryan. Sometimes Dan Bryan is agent, and I'm the buyer. Now, when we get to closing, there's a trust involved and a trustee, and it's usually not me as trustee. So, once I go under contract, I then if I'm if I'm diligent, I create the trust right away, you know, so I get it notarized, I get all the documents done. And then I just assign my contract to the trust. And I send the title company an assignment, because if my contract says Dan Bryan as a buyer, you know, they're gonna want to put it in Dan Bryan's name. I'm gonna need to give them some paperwork. You know, I gotta connect the dots for them. So if I assign the contract to the trust at the time the trust is created, guess what's in the trust now? A contract.
So that would be equitable interest.
Absolutely. It's been explained as you could put a piece of lint in the trust. We just have to state that the lint's in there. Otherwise, we're talking about something theoretically. If someone ever came and challenged the validity of the trust based on the timing, you know, I've never been involved in any or know of anybody. However, it's happened. You know, not in real estate that I'm aware of, but it has happened in the past under some case. But so I always try to cover all the bases. But as soon as you sign the contract in there, then the contract's that's a corpus of the trust. It's what's in the trust. So
I've interviewed a few lawyers and they question the validity of a holding trust. You know, and I think it's probably because they're not familiar with it or what, but or they're trying to promote a different thing, but
we're talking about Missouri property or
what's that?
We talking Missouri property?
Yes.
Okay.
Have you ever had any of these challenged?
Oh yeah. No, I've never, but I mean, yeah, I mean, you know what? So there's six states that have a land trust statute that specifically establish this type of trust. And what makes a land trust different from a regular estate planning trust is we don't have enough time to go into today, but basically in effect, it's control. One of the biggest things is we maintain control. We're not going to give it to the trustee. The trustee can only act unless we give them direction to act. So that's the biggest reason without going into the other couple things about a land type trust. And why they were originally created. So there's six states that specifically have statute. Missouri is not one of them. They started in Illinois. So the states that have trust statute tailored it after Illinois. In fact, some of them were even better than the Illinois statute because they had the benefit of the court cases that came in Illinois for over 100 years when they created their statute. So however, it's a trust is valid in all 50 states. I bought and sold an insured title with no problem. There are a couple legal concepts under the law that, referring to the statute of uses and land trust, that Missouri has not ever gotten rid of the statute of uses. And I probably shouldn't even mention it because it's too complicated to go into now, but I've never had an issue. There are certain title insurers who will not insure a trust if they know it to be a land trust. We don't use the word land trust in our trust anymore, but it's effectively the same type of trust, no matter what it's called. But, you know, because it has the same provisions in there. I can tell you Old Republic Title, I used to close with them. I had closed 50 to 70 land trust transactions with them. And they decided they're a very conservative insurer. They sent a title commitment out to me and says, if this is an Illinois type land trust, we will not insure title. And I immediately called the owner and the underwriter who I knew from talking to him. And he said, Dan, we've just decided we don't want to be the test case. There's not been any in Missouri, but we don't want to be that test case as to whether the it's a valid trust or not. And I mentioned a few other things. He said, yeah, I agree with you. But he said the Old Republic, their councils decided they don't want to take on the risk. So guess what? I changed title companies. That was 15 years ago or 12 years ago. And I'm closing with another title company. And I know a lot of other title companies will close them. So, and I know title insurers will insure them. So it's not been a problem for me. So, but I'm about full disclosure. Yeah, you're right. you when you find attorneys, and I would the same thing. I went to my corporate attorney. I had an electrical contracting business. I had a same corporate attorney for years. I went to him about this type of trust. He said, I don't know, just make an LLC. I don't know why you do that trust thing. And then, but I know other attorneys that, because privacy and what we're doing with it, they just, a lot of attorneys haven't taken the time to understand why. And it's not a, if you're creating your own trust, after they, even if they create the first one for you, there's no money in it for them. So you do have a hard time finding, not every attorney is going to be versed in this type of trust.
Hey, Dan. Hey, yeah. Dan, it's David Randolph. Yeah, for everybody on here, Investors Title recently won some kind of lawsuit that allows them to close in land trusts. So that's where I take mine to now, because they don't even bat an eye because they went to court, they won. And so now they don't care as long as you fill out that certificate of trust per Missouri Code 633. You fill out that certificate of trust, they are now washed and clean, and that's all you want. So Investors Title here in St. Louis.
Yeah, and they're a great title. That's a great title company. And by the name Investors Title, Joe Crutchfield, who owns that, they're very investor friendly. They're my backup title company, and only because I had another title company before them, not because they're any better or worse. But I've closed a lot of stuff with investors over the years, and Joe's very investor friendly, hence Investors Title. So you know, in life and in real estate especially, I look for someone that says, tells me how to do something. Don't tell me no, tell me how. And, you know, I got this from someone else. You know, when a title company says, we can't do that, well, then tell me what I need to do to make it. Remember, they're taking some risk. They get audited. They have to be able to meet their insurers, their title insurer guidelines. Most title companies are owned by attorneys, so they're smart in their own right. They may or may not understand land trust. Some do, some don't. I mean, when I first started using land trust, I got a phone call from an attorney because I had a buyer who backed out hours before closing, backed out. It was an investor buyer. And I've not had any, many closings. That did. And I said, okay, that's fine. We'll just keep the earnest money. I mean, it was $1,000, I think. No, it might've been 2000. And it was 2000, I think. This has been more than 10, 12 years ago. And the attorney called me and he started threatening me with this, you know, we don't even know that this land trust is legal you're trying to sell from. And I said, well, you know, I said, this is not an argument about whether the land trust is legal. I said, the title company was insuring title, so your buyer's got nothing to worry about. And so he started threatening me that I was using some kind of illegal form of trust. And he was going to, and I said, great, bring it on. I said, or call your client back and tell him you strong-armed me and we'll split the earnest money. I said, because look, I can go toe-to-toe with you on this land trust stuff. And you know, if you think you got a case, bring it on. But I know how earnest money works. First, there was only a couple grand involved. The title company was going to hold on to it till someone released it, or they were going to turn it over to Missouri after the time limit expired. Well, guess what? Tell your client you got me to split it with him, and I'll agree to that. Because otherwise, neither one of us gets anything. And that's what he did. He called and said Facebook. Well, first of all, he said he's going to call me back in 20 minutes because he thought this was an illegal thing. And then he called me back and said, oh, yeah, I had a change of heart. You know, and he came to see it my way. So, I mean, there was always going to be people in life to say you can't do something or shouldn't do something. But there's plenty of professionals out there. You know, and I think there's several people on the call here that's been to my class. So, if you liked it, tell people about it. If not, you know, it's just an option for people. So, I mean, I like it. I eat and breathe the stuff. So it's fun for me. So, and if we run into a problem, we collectively work together. I mean, I get phone calls from people and say, hey, we run into this problem. We talk about it. We usually figure out a solution pretty quickly.
Okay. You want to move on to, we got a couple more questions here, Dan. Tony Bernard, click here next to the line here on the, go ahead.
Okay. I got a couple of questions here. But real quick, the first thing I wanted to find out is the class is not starting until the end of the year. Where can I get some documents and some information where I can get started now?
Well, I'm probably going to do the class in a couple of months. I'm just trying to firm up on a date. you know, you could go out there and Google land trust. Be careful, yeah. There's different kinds of land trust out there. Bill Bronchek writes a good book. He's a Florida attorney, How to Use Land Trust. He's got two of them. I think they're still in print. One's How to Use Land Trust in Florida. One's How to Use Land Trust in Other States. It's a good book. It's fairly.
Do you have any of your forms available now, Dan?
I don't have any of my stuff that I offer right now, but shoot me an email and, you know, we might can figure something out. You know, sometimes, you know, I'll get to class, you know, if someone's really anxious, I'll, you know, I'm working on the final manual too. I change my manual every year. As years go on, there's less changes to it, but I always add some material based on things that have happened or other material I want to add to it. So, and anything I've revised or clauses I've added, I add that to it. So sometimes I've made, you know, we might can work something out where you get the material maybe in advance or something of the class. Okay. So.
Okay. And Dan, one more question. Can you share your best tip for picking a trustee?
I use people, not companies. We talking long-term holds or are we talking flips?
Long-term holds for rentals.
Okay. Best tip is an out-of-state person, out-of-state address. You know, that's the best. Now, do I always use that? No, but that's the best. Without going into a lot of detail, that's who's going to get served if there's a problem. You got to decide what address to use on the trust. There's a lot of factors to decide what is best to use. What address, what mailing address do you use? Now, if it's the out-of-state trustee, you can use their trust, their address. But they're also going to get the tax bills and all the other stuff that come with property ownership. Of course, all that stuff's online now, so it's not like it's a big deal. So,
got it. Okay. All right. Thanks.
Okay, Dwayne, you got your hand up here.
One simple question for Dan. When we were talking about beneficiary deeds, do you know, is it grossed up? Like if I give you you're my beneficiary and then I pass, does that get grossed up to current market value when you get it?
I think it does. I think it passes. I'm not positive on that, on the tax. I will check on that though, but I think that's true. I think it passes. I think it passes at current rate. Just like it would pass in any other situation, in probate or wherever. I think it passes the same way. So,
yeah, until the Biden administration changes that. So die quickly.
Hold on to your hats. I think we're in for some tax changes.
Okay, I see Ann just put her hand up. Go ahead, Ann.
Yeah, question. Is there any privacy in removing the information from the records of deed list in the assessor's office?
Sure, that helps. I mean, you know, if you file that, I think you have to file it every year, though. At least that's how it used to be, where you can go to the county and ask that your name be kept private. Yeah, that helps, certainly.
Oh, great. Okay, thank you.
That can help. Just remember, you got to renew that. And not every county offers that. Not every county and area offers that. I know St. Louis County does.
Okay. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Okay. So Heath had his hand up earlier. Did you get your question answered or just get tired? Did your arm get tired with your hand up? I think you might have answered it because he took it down while you were talking and answered somebody else's question. And he's not on right now. Okay, anybody else got anything? I see, let's see, Alex in the chat asked a question. Do you have to use a separate checking account for maintenance and improvements?
I don't. I actually use an LLC to manage all my properties, separate LLC that does not own anything. That's just the way I do it.
I can, if you're interested in another person's opinion, I have 8 LLCs. They all have their individual separate checking accounts. I have 8 checkbooks, 8 debit cards. I know it's crazy, but it keeps me honest. It keeps the accounts real straightforward and it prevents the problem of commingling funds. You're taking personal funds, putting them in your checking account and using some of it towards your LLC expenses and so on. So any accountant will tell you that's a nightmare. So you would want to stay away from that. But there's a price, and the cost to pay is there's 8 checkbooks to carry. There's 8 debit cards to carry.
I would agree. If you're going to use a separate management company, you need to have your documents. You need to have, first of all, an accurate accounting method, and you need to make sure that the LLC has an agreement, or the trust has an agreement for the LLC to manage. And, you know, but we do not create separate checking accounts in all the trust names. There are occasions when we might have a trust account, but it's not in one of the trust names that hold property. So, that's what I do. Rakesh is right about that. The absolute best way is to have separate everything for everything. But, you know, at some point that becomes unwieldy. You know, if you got 50 properties and you got 50 checking accounts and 50 LLCs, I think that's
it's a scaling problem.
If you've got a few and to learn, it's probably a great way to do it, because it does force you to be honest and keep, you know, and you're less likely to quote unquote pierce the corporate veil in terms of, you know, if you got into a lawsuit and someone was going to claim that you co-mingled funds, you know. So, but, you know, it can be done properly, so you're still not commingling. It just takes discipline too. So,
yeah, Dan, I'll chime in on that same thing. We've done it for ever since I've been here in Missouri, about 18 years, and by doing them basically a column, and every one of those is an individual, you know, everything that's got to do with that property. And then when we get a distribution, if we need it in another company, we got to distribute it to ourselves and then put it in another company. And it works fine. That's been the status quo for years and years in Missouri. And I've never had any hassle with that at all. And I've listened to the attorneys talk about, no, you got to have all this stuff, but that's just unbearable.
You know, and the other thing is, I mean, you can't protect against every potential. Do good business out there. You know, if I have an issue with someone, a tenant or whatever, or a vendor, try to work it out. I mean, you know, it's easier to, I'd rather pay an unhappy tenant to leave than even have them to try to, you know, I kind of learned that the tenant business, and I get along with my tenants well, you know, and tenants know if they can't pay, call me. Let's figure out how you're going to move. Figure out solutions rather than answers. It'll keep you out of lawsuits too, but you know, I've got those other layers of protection with trust that I think help me too. So.
Okay. I see another question in the chat. Sam is asking, do you cover revocable living trusts in your class?
When we talk about, the land trust is a revocable living trust, but mm-hmm. we don't go into big detail on the estate planning trust as far as creating one. And I do have a sample in the class that you can use. Or you could take with you at least to have a start. I recommend if someone's going to do a living trust, you know, get some education, but then have an attorney help you with that. Someone that does trust planning, not just a run-of-the-mill attorney, but someone that really does estate planning, because it can get complicated. Unless you've got a very simple estate, you know, how to name your beneficiaries and how you exactly want things to happen. Because when you die, the living trust is the only thing that they're going to rely on. That's going to tell them what to do. The trustee's obligated to carry out whatever you intended to have done. So we touch on it, but it's not the main, you know, our main focus is on the title holding trust. So, which is very, very similar. And it is a type of living trust. So.
Yeah. I heard you use both the words living and revocable in your description of the grantor trust.
Right. That's the funny thing about trust. Every trust can meet 4 or 5 different things. It's an express trust. It's an inter vivos, which inter vivos just means living. It means you created it while you were living. Guess what? You know, because some trusts are created when you die, or you know, there it's not an inter vivos trust. You know, and there's not irrevocable trusts that you can't easily change, or technically, you know, you can't change them unless there are some reasons you can change irrevocable. But yeah, man. The land trust is very similar to a living type trust without maybe the estate provisions, and it's got some special provisions in it to make it a land trust.
So one last comment for me is that I had taken Dan's class initially. I bought one out of a trust, a piece of property. And I was really glad I understood what they were looking for in all that paperwork. And after doing that, then I took it again and it all made a whole lot more sense to me. And when you look at how many old people are getting these trusts drawn up, you'd be really smart as an investor to already know what that means. So that's a cheap plug for Dan, but he's really got great class.
I will too. Yeah, I've taken his class too, and years ago. I probably should take it again to get a refresher and get that new material he's offering.
I've got the record 4 or 5 times I've taken Dan's class, and nobody I'll be back well to this one again.
Dave,
I'll be back again if Dan will give me a date.
Okay, I'm glad you guys oppressed me for that, because it comes easy. It gets easy to just get caught in what you do every day. And I really do love teaching the trust class. It takes a little bit out of me, but I love teaching it. So I'm glad folks are asking about it.
I'll be there again.
Yeah, and we will send. We'll be sending out an email when Dan gives us a date. We'll be sending an email out to all of our membership. So
And anyone on this call will offer certainly get the discount and any discount offered. And in the meantime, if you got questions or something, shoot a quick email to me if I can answer it quickly. It's about education, and you won't learn this in one bite. Because even when you kind of think you got it, something else comes up like, oh my goodness, I don't know what to do here. And that's what happened to me. But it's fun if you like it. So.
Yep.
Please set it up, Dan.
Okay, will do, John. Mm-hmm. Thanks for having me tonight.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Appreciate you coming on with us and spreading your knowledge to the masses.
I hope I didn't go too long. I didn't know how long this was going to go. It's a little different format, so.
Perfect.
Perfect. Yeah, it's good. No, it's all good. All good. I just want to also give another plug for next month. John has got Joe Vornador lined up to speak, coming from Note School, talk about purchasing mortgages and notes. If you want to get into that business, and it's a good another way of investing in real estate in a different way.
And you can hold those notes in a trust. I
can hold those in a trust, though. Yeah, no use for trust to hold those notes.
Yes.
Okay, John, you got anything else? Any closing remarks you want to put in or?
No, just watch your inbox and always, as always, check your bulk or your spam, because sometimes the servers send your stuff there. But we got a lot of good stuff coming up. Thank you so much tonight, Dan. It's so much detail, but you explain it so simply, and we do appreciate it. I'm looking forward to your class. As soon as you can get that set up, we'll get it sent out. And
all right, sounds good.
Thank you so much. That's all
I got. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. And thank you all for joining us tonight. And we'll see you next time.
Thank you.